heart is a blue. Shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck, and the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck. Take you out of this place. Someone you can lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful.
A beautiful day. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. You too, a beautiful day. Let me first thank a couple of persons before I start this little show in 45 minutes. The first one to thank is Samsung and Tria for letting the screen over here. And the next one I want to thank is Katharina for putting our video together so beautifully. So thank you so much. You too. Yeah, let's give a big applause to Katharina. The hotel show manager of today. You too, a beautiful day. It is, I think, and I hope so. Who is a big fan of you too? Let's start with the first question. Raise your hands, please, if you are a big fan of you too. One, two. I think we are a couple of hundreds over here, so only two or three are here, a big fan of you too. And me neither. I'm not a big fan of you too either. So the reason I took you two to the stage today has got a different reason. You two is the most sustainable performer of all bands in the last 50 years. This band is together for 40 years already, created 30 albums, and of those 30 albums, 20 albums at number one. My question to you is, how do you do so? How can you be a big, a great performer, a sustainable performer in your business? I've got only 45 minutes, and we're going to do that together. Energetic, interactive. So please, the next question is to you, how and what does it take to be a sustainable performer? How did you do this marvelous job? So Queen with Freddie Mercury comes close, the Rolling Stones come close, but you two is the most sustainable performing band ever. How? How can you be a sustainable performer like you two? What can we learn from you two? Up to you.
Bring quality.
Yeah, bring quality. How do you bring quality over and over again? So this band made album number 12 and said to each other, let's go full speed for number 14 and number 15, number 16, number 17. They made 30 albums, and of those, 20 albums at number one, let alone all those number one hits. How do you do so? What does it take to be a great performer? We're going to speak about the most difficult and most important task of a leader, of an entrepreneur. And this task is continuity. It's all about continuity. We were going to speak about a social phenomenon. I studied for 20 years. The only thing to study, to my opinion, is this social phenomenon, and it's called the kiss of death. And you will never forget this phenomenon again. It's all in life about the kiss of death. Please, if you want to, take a pencil, take a paper, and write with me so we can have gainings for this afternoon. The kiss of death, what could it be? What could it mean? You all should be aware about the kiss of death. I have been an entrepreneur for 15 years. I had about 450 people in my own company, became a scientist afterwards, and I studied only as a parent now for two youngsters, two boys, this most important task, the kiss of death. What could it be? We're going to speak about the kiss of death in 40 minutes, but what is it? Yeah. It stays quiet. Most leaders step in when they should step out and step out when they should step in. Please step in. What does it take to be a big and great performer? What could the kiss of death mean? And you will never forget about the kiss of death. It's going to be a pleasant afternoon, but we start with a little bit urgency. The kiss of death. May I ask, who is an entrepreneur in this room? Who is a leader in this room? Who wants to be a leader in this room? And who wants to have a great leader in their own companies? And I've got you all. Who is a parent in this room? So the kiss of death should be in your heads. It's all about the kiss of death in our lives. What could it be? It's going to be a pleasant afternoon, but it's going to be about trust. But trust is a gaining, it is a result of safety. The number task one of leaders is to remain safety. And you see all those issues in the media about safety. If there is safety in your companies, there is safety in your teams, you will gain trust. But it is a result. It can be made, it can be broken. It's all about remaining and having safety on our teams. At this moment, to give a number, 1.8 million people work in a toxic environment. 1.8 people work in a toxic environment. Why? Because the worst style of leadership is at hand. And we will speak about the best and the most difficult style of leadership, but also about the most stressful, the most destructive style of leadership. And that's seeable everywhere. The kiss of death, ladies and gentlemen, what is it? We have got only 1/2 an hour left. I will not do grades this afternoon, but we are going to do it energetic and interactive. Don't correct if somebody is doing wrong. Yeah, that's a good one, because everybody should raise their bars and have to make faults, should make, be able to make faults. But the kiss of death is something else. If you are a leader, if you are an entrepreneur, the kiss of death is on your feet. If you have children, they will face the kiss of death multiple times in their lives. What is the kiss of death? Think about the story of you two. They had the kiss of death on their feet, but came across the kiss of death. Thank you. I will come to you. Stop innovating, stop changing. Yeah, we're going to have it about innovation. About resilience. About facing the kiss of death. Almost there, but not complete. Stepping out of the?
Into the void.
Stepping into the void, yeah. So be unique. You are unique, but step aside. Be unique in everything you do. Not knowing who you are. The most important thing about leadership, know thyself. And that's a difficult one because we change. I'm a teacher in a learning authentic leadership. But know that every 7 years, every cell in your body has changed. The only thing didn't change are your teeth. So you change every 7 years. So how can we be authentic? We are just travelers. The kiss of death, what could it be? I see big eyes.
At any given point,
it's all over. You are correct. If you think you're there,
You're not even close. What's your name, sir?
Dan.
Dan, fantastic. Dan, stepping in, stepping out. The kiss of death is all about this one. It's not about unique results. It's about to be a sustainable performer. How to be a U2 as a company, as a team, as a leader, as a parent. It's all about our traveling. It's all about the journey. We win and we lose. So it's all about our energy to be a sustainable performer. But how to maintain that energy? What does it take to be a great performer like U2? I will give some aspects on paper. 6 variables that are at stake every day, every month, every year, that has to be unique to be a sustainable performer. Write with me, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to. The L of leadership, I will use my pencil. The L of leadership in the left above. The second one is work motivation. The third one is performance or results. The fourth one is strategy. The fifth one is culture. And the sixth one is organizational structures. All those aspects, all those variables are important to be a sustainable performer. At a university like mine, we've got a professor at every aspect here on paper. But there is only one aspect, the most important in your teams, in your companies, in your entrepreneurs. Which variable is the most important one? Business administration is so very difficult. It seems so easy, but there is one word that is most central, and that is the word alignment. Everything is aligned. Which aspect is the most important one? Which to focus on as a leader, as an entrepreneur, as a parent? Which aspect is the most important thing to your opinion? And I call upon Dan. Dan, please. We only have got 30 minutes. But who else? What do you think? What's your opinion? What is the most important aspect for overcoming the kiss of death? What is the most important one in your teams? Strategy. It all starts with strategy. Know your strategy. But then, I'm sorry, it's not the most important one. If you're in a big discussion with professors, it's going to be a long day. But we only take about 30 seconds to have the common view on this little question. Which one is the most important aspect in your variable, in your company, in your teams? Results at the end. Continuity have 2 pillars, and that's your task as a leader. At the 20th of the month, you are being paid to have controlled 2 aspects. And the first one is safety. It all starts with safety. And the second one is results. Without results, no continuity. So we have results needed to continue our story. It starts with safety. How can you continue delivering performance results? Motivation. At the end, we've got so little time. It's all about this variable. The most important asset, if you can call it an asset, are your people. How motivated are your employees? How motivated are your leaders? How motivated are yourself to continue performing? Look back to you too. How can you continue your work motivation? And work motivation can be made and can be broken, firstly, by leadership. Leadership follows strategy. Strategy has an influence on work motivation. Culture, indeed, and the same. And the score will take care of itself. The most important aspect, your employees, are not in your balance sheets. And still we want to know something about tomorrow. We want to know about what can we expect in 2023? What can we expect in 2024? How motivated are my employees? 90% of all organizations use job satisfaction surveys to have an impact, to have a view on work motivation. Stop doing so. Stop having job satisfaction surveys. Why? Why is it so important to have arguments to say, let's stop job satisfaction surveys? What does job satisfaction say? And I'm sorry to tell, but 90% of all your organizations use job satisfaction surveys. Stop doing so. Stop having a vision and stop having a mission statement. Leadership is about letting instead of doing. You don't need a vision and you don't need a mission. You don't need job satisfaction. What does job satisfaction say? By definition, it says something about the past. I have been satisfied and the bar is too low. We're going to raise the bar today. It's not about job satisfaction. It's also not about job engagement. You can be engaged on four different ways. You can be engaged in your job. I'm very engaged in my job. May I have a grade? Let's say a 9. You can be engaged by your colleagues. I work together with these people for 20 years. May I have a grade? A 9, the same. You can be engaged with your organization. Doesn't matter too much. That's a 6. And you can be engaged by your leader. .f... I don't grade them a 4. The average is 7.5. Most leaders step in when they should step out and step out when they should step in. Today, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to raise the bar. We're not going to speak about job satisfaction, also not about job engagement. We're going to speak, and for the Dutch in this room, we're going to speak about bevlogenheid. Work engagement of Deutsch begeistering. Maybe there are some Belgian people in the room. Goesting. What is work engagement, bevlogenheid, begeistering different than job satisfaction and engagement? I'm not just satisfied, I'm activated. I'm activated and I'm passionate and I'm being characterized by 3 elements: vitality, dedication, absorption. 3 aspects we use in science to see and to observe work engagement, bevlogenheid. Vitality, dedication, absorption. Ladies and gentlemen, you've got a high level of absorption at this moment. And we're going to keep it that way till 5 o'clock. But what is it? What could absorption mean? As a leader, I firstly observe how is the level of absorption in an individual and in my teams. It says it all. Lead as a leader, as a wolf. Lead from behind. The most overestimated characteristic, skill of a leader is listening. Listening is the most overestimated skill of a leader. People say everything they want to say to you. Learn to observe. You can tell me anything, but if I observe a different attitude, I know that's not the case. Lead from behind, lead as a wolf. I'm observing you guys for now 50 minutes on absorption. What does it mean? The most important element of work motivation, to my opinion, is absorption. But what is it? We're going to learn together today. Energetic, interactive, absorption. Learn to absorb absorption levels in your teams. What does it say? What is the definition? You observe values, yeah. I'm going to step into the room. People step in when they should step out and step out when they should step in. What could absorption mean?
Watch the body language also.
What kind of?
Just understand.
Understanding, yeah. So learn to understand. But absorption means something different. It's not about resilience. It's not about being adaptable. It's something else. I see big eyes, and that's all about absorption. What does it mean? Making connection, yeah.
Willingness to learn.
Fantastic. Your name is, madam. Francis, perfect Francis, but the bar is going to be raised. It's not only about the willingness to learn. Knowledge was a possession. Absorption is an attitude. And I want to observe this attitude. Not only the willingness to learn, but to have an attitude to gain as much as knowledge I can gain to be a better performer today, not only for myself, but for my team and for my whole organization. Learn to spread knowledge. Knowledge wasn't obsession, wasn't possession. Absorption is an attitude. Learn to observe this attitude. We're going to speak about the kiss of death. It's not about unique results. It's all about this little animal. Who is familiar with this animal? A fish fly, yeah, almost. You two, a beautiful day. 40 years together, 30 albums, 20 albums are number one. What is this little animal? It's all about a beautiful day. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the one day fly. And nobody wants to be the one day fly. And so, such a little joke, what a shame if you don't have your day. It's all about sustainable performance. How to be a sustainable performance? I will give you the numbers in the Netherlands. At this moment, only 12% of all employees is fully engaged, is fully passionate. 77% of all youngsters is not happy in their jobs. 6% is having and facing a burnout, and another 30% almost there. The numbers are falling down. 1 in 5 employees changed their jobs in your sector last year. 1 in 3 is trying to do so. How can you be a sustainable performance if you don't have the right employees or they are leaving your company? Let's create a conceptual model facing this problem. My first question to you, do we live in times of high or low turbulence? High turbulence, the T of turbulence on paper. If you're facing high levels of turbulence, does your fear and do your fears and uncertainty raise or fall down? Do they increase or decrease? They, of course, increase your fears and uncertainty, and that we call a positive correlation. Maybe good to tell something about world leadership. 99% of all people face this positive correlation. 98% of all men face this correlation. And then you probably can tell, I know at least 100 women, and I know at least at least 50 men. Who are those? We call them the antisocial psychological disorders. People who don't have fears don't have uncertainties. 7 characteristics, 7 elements. The first one and the most important one, they don't have fears and uncertainties. The second one is all about their gatings. They cheat and lie always. High levels of narcissism, but they are not really the narcissists. 7 elements of this disorder. And you know all people on world level as a leader who have this disorder. They don't face fears and uncertainties. It's all about their gainings and power. They cheat and lie all day long. Which name comes across? Trump is always number one, but at these times, sometimes number two. And Putin comes first these days. So listening is the most overestimated skill. If we would have listened to Putin, he would not have attacked Ukraine this day. Learn to observe. Who else? Bolsonaro. Who else? Boris Johnson. Set Britain on fire. Set himself as a fireman. Mentioned the water was done. Had a couple of years of being prime minister and have some parties. At this moment, there are a lot of world leaders with this disorder. My question to you guys is, how can it be that we, as electors in a democracy, say, just do so. You cheat on me, you lie on me, it's all about your gatings. but please do so. What does Trump have to do to not be chosen again? Ladies and gentlemen, how can it be that these leaders are being chosen by us? They all trigger us on fear. They put their countries, their system in turbulent times. They give us fear and uncertainties. And we say, if you're so self-confident, be my leader. In animal kingdom, who is being chosen as a leader in times of turbulence, crisis, and fears? Who's being chosen as a leader in natural, at animal kingdom? And that's indeed, is the alpha, is the silverback. But ladies and gentlemen, who is being chosen by elephants, by hyenas, by wolves, by orcas, as a leader in times of turbulence, fears, and uncertainties? And that's not the silverback, and that's not the alpha. And that's the king mother, the most wisest animal around. Ladies and gentlemen, we live in times that the female kind of leadership, the female style of leadership, is the most preferred one. And we see all in an organization the man lead, the dominant style of leadership. The female style of leadership is all about giving attention, coaching, feedback, not having a mission, not having a vision, but giving direction. Just a step aside. If you face fears and uncertainties, does your need for control decrease or increase? Of course, it increases, a positive correlation. If I, as your leader, would control you more and more, if you control your team members more and more, if you control the I and Z generation more and more, does their levels of passion decrease or increase? They decrease rapidly. Levels of passion are negative correlation. If the most important aspect in your organization, your teams, decrease the work motivation, do the performance or the results grow or diminish? And they, of course, diminish very fastly. The results go down, and we call that a positive correlation. More higher levels of passion, higher levels of results and performance. And we're almost there. If the levels of performance and results decrease and diminish in your teams, in your households, in your organization, does the level of turbulence increase or decrease? And of course, it decreases and increases turbulence, and we call this a vicious cycle of Deutsch ein Teufelskreis. Ladies and gentlemen, we leaders destroy our own companies. Let's have this vicious cycle the opposite way around. What can you do as a leader? As a leader to be, as a professional, as a parent, to have this cycle the other way around? Which variable can you control? This is happening in 90% of all organizations in the Netherlands, and I can tell in the Western world. Bureaucracy is everywhere. 40% of all times and means in the healthcare sector in the Netherlands is being used by bureaucracy. In primary education, 35% at this moment. If you use your times and means in natural kingdom like this, being frozen, you will be dead in a minute. You cannot do this. What can you change in this vicious cycle? Only this one. This correlation, do not use your healthy fears by using the wrong kind of control mechanism. We're going to speak about four control mechanisms today. The first and most important one is personal control. Who to recruit, who to select in your companies. We select and recruit the wrong people. And we will do that in a scientific way in a minute. The second control you can use is about leadership. Cultural control. Most leaders step in when they should step out and step out when they should step in. We've all got three triggers at stake: ego, fears, and too much of empathy. Step out when you can, step in when you have to. When do you step in? When safety is at stake, when results are at stake. When can you step out? All the other aspects. If safety is good, results is good, step out and lead as a wolf. Lead from behind. Put your ego aside, put your too much of empathy aside, and don't be feared. Personal control, cultural control, the third one you can use, we call that one action control. To use all split tasks, structures, protocols in your company and measure those. A system of distrust. The fourth control you can use is all about result control. I will give you all professional autonomy, but results have to be there. I will control your results, but how you do that, I don't care. We're going to speak about the first one. This is the kiss of death. Time and success. We all had success, but then people drop. To have the second and the first success, that's difficult. And the first quote is there: talent is good, character is better. It's all about one aspect, the kiss of death. The show must go on. We are travelers, we need continuity. Let's go to this little movie. What does it take to be a performer like you too? Who's familiar with this movie? Maybe better to even start, who's familiar with this guy? And then I see only smiling faces, especially by the females. Brad Pitt. But Brad Pitt plays a guy, and this guy is named Billy Bean. Does anyone know the name Billy Bean? The character, the person Billy Bean? He's still alive. Has anyone heard about Billy Bean? Nobody. Billy Bean was the most talented American youngster ever. Billy Bean could do any sports. He was 15, he could do rugby. Billy Bean could do baseball, he could do basketball, he could do American football. Billy Bean could do it all at the age of 15. At the age of 16, he chose for baseball. And at the age of 16, he made records who does still stand after 40 years in history. Billy Bean was the best in his sports ever. In the number three sports in the world, Billy Bean was the best. Billy Bean got a $1 million contract by the Auckland A's at the age of 17. His parents very happy, his coaches very happy. The only person who wasn't very happy was Billy Bean. Billy Bean didn't want to play baseball. He wanted to do something with his head, with his ratio. And Billy Bean went to Stanford University to have an executive MBA. Billy Bean got his executive MBA at Stanford University and got back as a general manager at the Auckland A's. And to have a picture of the Auckland A's is like Excelsior in our football competition. The highest competition, but the lowest ranked. The lowest budgets. Billy Bean came back to the Auckland A's as the general manager. And the first thing Billy Bean did, he fired all scouts, all recruiters, because Billy Bean knew they select people by mirror. They look like me, on talent, like me, and not about character. I will show you a little piece of the movie Moneyball. Billy Bean together with a professor of Stanford University, Paul DePodesta.
So using this equation in the upper left right here, I'm projecting that we need to win at least 99 games in order to make it to the postseason. We need to score at least 814 runs in order to win those games and allow no more than 645 runs.
What's this?
This is the code that I've written for our year-to-year projections. This is building in all the intelligence that we have to project players.
Okay.
It's about getting things down to one number. using the stats the way we read them, we'll find value in players that nobody else can see. People are overlooked for a variety of biased reasons and perceived flaws. Age, appearance, personality. Bill James and mathematics cut straight through that. Billy, of the 20,000 notable players for us to consider, I believe that there is a championship team of 25 people that we could afford, because everyone else in baseball undervalues them. Like an island of misfit toys.
Island of misfit toys. How about us? How many people in the Netherlands, in the Western world, don't get the chance they deserve to be in your teams, in your organization? How many people don't deserve a chance in your teams, in your organization? People are overlooked and undervalued because we don't use statistics. We select and recruit by stomach and by intuition, mostly in the first couple of minutes. Who of you use statistics and science to recruit and select the right people? Nobody does. We all do it by stomach feeling and intuition. Let's have Moneyball in our own teams or organization. We all select the wrong people, to my opinion. Let's get some arguments at stake. To what degree are certain personality traits and success criteria important for sustainable performance by professionals here in the Netherlands? That was my main question after seeing this little movie. I hired 450 people, mostly the wrong persons. I had some hypotheses. Firstly, how important is talent these days for performance? If you've got talent, how important are some personality traits? If you have those, how important is work engagement we spoke about? And we've got the overline. Let's have the underline. How important is the fit with the organization? And within the organization, the fit with those job demands. And everything is aligned. Seven hypotheses, all important in our organization to be a sustainable performance. Let's dive in. These are the most 20 most important selection criteria. If you read, you will get my slides by management. Please have a pen and paper at hand. If you read about personal leadership, if you read about recruitment, if you read about selection, those aspects, those personality traits and success criteria are always there. I will make you now CEO of your own company. My question to you guys is, which are the five most important criteria to hire a new person? If you're being a parent, on which personality trait or success criteria would you focus your child more and more to have a bigger chance to overcome the kiss of death? Please take a pen and paper. We will have a little quiz in 3-4 minutes. Moneyball at the Independent Show here in Amsterdam. Don't write the number on paper. Write the aspects on paper. The most important five criteria to your opinion. How to select, how to recruit the best professional in your company. It took me 7 years to answer, in all modesty, this question. I will give you 90 seconds to have your levels of absorption as high as possible. When you are thinking, I will give you some numbers extra. What are the costs involved if you hire the wrong personnel? In the Netherlands, to hire the wrong professional, in average, will cost you 1.5 years of annual salary. To hire the wrong leader in your company, about 3 years of annual salaries. We hire and select by intuition, by stomach feeling. The cost price is enormously. We all select as youngsters. People are above 50 don't get any chances in the Netherlands. Do you have a list of five at this moment? See some knocking and nicking. Yeah? Everyone ready? Let's dive in. The most important aspects. These are the numbers 2 till 9. For every aspect on paper, you will get yourself 2 points. The number 1 is not there. So you can have a 10, but it will be a 10 minus because the most important one is not there. Who's got a 10 on paper at this moment? 5 aspects, we've got 9, just here 8 on this slide. Who has got a 10 already? Who has got an 8? Perfect, because this can be the perfect score. Your name is?
Cameron.
Cameron? Cameron. Cameron. Cameron's got an 8. And because the number 1 is not there already, you can have the perfect score. So my question to you is, which one do you miss? Which one do you lack? But which, the number 1 is not there. You have the perfect score. Or you only wrote 4. So you will be helped by your colleagues. Which one do you lack? Which one do you think is the most important one to be a sustainable performer? And this was by far the number 1. Absorption was the number 10. I'm sorry, but significant correlators. Ambition was the number 15. Ambition can be dangerous. So some of you know the Peter principle. You're being raised by the level of competency. Ambition can be. So it's all about time. It's all about now. It's all about self-efficacy. Every animal in animal kingdom has got its own unique self-efficacy. If you lack that self-efficacy, then you will be killed. A leopard with 3 legs will be killed. He needs a speed. Every animal has got his own self-efficacy. We create equal people in our companies. We are not equal, we are equally worthy. You've got unique talents, a unique experience to do your job, the same job, in a different way. Self-efficacy is the most important one. This one was the answer of the 50 biggest CEOs of the Netherlands, the CEOs of Philips, Unilever, Shell, they all cooperated. And their answer, number 1, was talent. And then you ask, what is talent in your eyes? Then they say, it's all about diplomas, it's all about experience. What do diplomas say? Diplomas, they only say the motivation from the past, to have the information from the past being settled into diplomas of the past. Doesn't say anything about my current knowledge, doesn't say anything about my current ambition and work motivation. Talent is good, character is everything. Let's get back to the most important one, self-efficacy. What is it? I will show you.
Pietertje, kom maar even wisselen, jongen. Goed gedaan, Pieter. Dat is steeds beter.
Ik kan echt niet voetballen, hè, Pieter? Nee.
People in the Netherlands know this little movie, self-efficacy. Only 15 to 70% we use in a normal average day are self-efficacy. Why? Because the vicious circle, over-controlling. Self-efficacy as an individual, don't look for the perfect function, look for the perfect environment, and you will create your own function. As an organization, don't look for the perfect candidate, look for the perfect character. Use science in your selection and recruitment. This is a selection model, personality traits, self-efficacy, adaptability, intrinsic motivation, intelligence. Look for the fit with the leader. Not the fit with the culture, the fit with the leader. In there, vitality, dedication, and the fit with mental job demands. You will get my slides. Use statistics, use your ratio to select the best people. The score will take care of itself. Let's get back to this little model. It's all about our legends, sustainable performance, about creating ambassadors as your clients. You don't need marketing if you create ambassadors. It's all about sustainable performance. I had only one question left with you two. What is the most sustainable performance sports team of the last 40 years? And because of time, I will show you. The All Blacks, 40 years together. In the last 40 years, they won 88% of all their games in the number two sport of the world. Very small country, very small population. How do you do so? And what can we learn from the All Blacks? How to recruit their personnel? They do that in four teams. Which team? First one, to have mana, engagement, work motivation. To have one Ubuntu organizational fit. To have one now, self-efficacy. And the most important one, to have Waka Papa. The fit with the high goal. To close this little masterclass seminar, may I ask you to stand? Then we're going to close this little thing. We have those four teams at hand at the All Blacks. I will say the Dutch, the English word, and you will give me the All Blacks, New Zealand's shouting word. Is that a deal? Okay, that's enough. Engagement heroes. Fantastic. Again, engagement heroes. Organizational fit? Wano. Self-efficacy? And then the most important one, may I ask you to raise your hands and to leave them on the shoulders of your neighbor and lean a little bit forward and give me a kiss of death. Independent Hotel Show, you are connected. Waka Papa! Fantastic. Talent is good, character is better. The show must go on. And a little closing to have this. Inviting me. Thanks for having me. Have a great day here at the Independent Hotel Show. Bye-bye.